The International Astronomical Union defines brown dwarfs as balls of gas in space that are too small to be bona fide hydrogen-burning stars, but large enough to burn deuterium, which anything bigger than about 13 times the mass of Jupiter can do. Because of this, brown dwarfs are often called failed stars or super-Jupiters. However, there's a major problem with this deuterium-burning-based definition. It doesn't make any scientific sense. First, unlike how hydrogen fusion is huge, since it means you can shine brightly for millions or billions of years, burning deuterium doesn't power or affect an astronomical object in any particularly meaningful way, which is probably why you haven't heard much about it. I mean, look at this density versus mass plot. Hydrogen burning is a cutoff that clearly distinguishes stars from non-hydrogen burning things, and then there's this other cutoff between gas giants and rocky planets, but deuterium burning doesn't appear distinguishing at all. So it may seem like there's no real distinction between things that are slightly too small to be stars, which we call brown dwarfs, and gas giant planets, and that they're all really the same kind of object. However, just because deuterium isn't a good cutoff doesn't mean there aren't other options. So let's briefly list the features that do scientifically distinguish brown dwarf-like objects from gas giant-like objects. And a caveat here, some of these statements are still being debated within the astronomical community, but for each one, there are at least some researchers arguing in favor of it. 1. Movement. Brown dwarfs, whether above or below the deuterium limit, and stars appear to be located and move in similar ways, in loose clusters with other similar objects moving with roughly the same relative speeds. Planets, on the other hand, move around stars or brown dwarfs in orbits and are much closer to the nearest star. 2. Formation. Brown dwarfs and stars appear to follow the same distribution of masses, suggesting they form the same way, the gravitational collapse of a cloud of gas and dust. Planets appear to follow a different distribution of masses, suggesting they form in their own way, by accreting from the protoplanetary disk of gas and dust left over around a star, or brown dwarf, after it forms. 3. Metallicity. The dust and gas left over from star formation has higher concentrations of metal, so the atmospheres of giant gas planets have elevated levels of metal. Brown dwarfs, on the other hand, have around the same amount of metal as stars. 4. The size of orbits. Protoplanetary disks around stars typically don't extend much farther than a few hundred times the distance between the Earth and the Sun, so that's about as far out as you find planets. However, brown dwarfs often orbit stars or other brown dwarfs at significantly greater distances. 5. Mass ratio. Protoplanetary disks are pretty much never more than 10% of the mass of their parent star, so a planet-to-star mass ratio is almost always less than 1 to 10. However, brown dwarfs and stars regularly orbit in pairs with mass ratios much closer to 1 to 1. Basically, a lot of evidence points to two separate populations of objects, things that form from gravitationally collapsing clouds of gas, and things that form from the leftovers. It appears an unfortunate coincidence that the overlap in these two populations is roughly at the mass where deuterium burning becomes possible. I mean, if we didn't have any other good way to distinguish between brown dwarfs and planets, sure, deuterium burning might be a reasonable rule of thumb. It's also possible, as some researchers contend, that there is no real clear way of distinguishing between brown dwarfs and giant planets, and that they really do just exist on a spectrum. But either way, deuterium is more or less a distraction. So among those who think that the evidence suggests brown dwarfs are different from giant planets, what supposedly distinguishes them is how they formed, their consequent behavior, and their composition. The claim is this: planets, no matter how big, appear to be the leftovers of star formation, and brown dwarfs, no matter how small, appear to be failed stars. They started off the same way stars do by gravitationally collapsing from a cloud of dust, but failed to capture enough mass to burn hydrogen. In the end, it doesn't matter how badly they failed. That is, it doesn't matter if they also can't burn deuterium. What matters is that they aspired to be stars and fell short. Thanks to NASA's James Webb Space Telescope project at the Space Telescope Science Institute for supporting this video. JWST is literally the perfect telescope for studying brown dwarfs. It sees best in infrared light, and guess what brown dwarfs mostly emit? Yep, infrared. Unlike stars, which are super hot, the smallest brown dwarfs are about the same temperature as you and me, so they give off infrared light right in the middle of JWST's spectrum. This also means that if you and I were in space, we'd shine out like a beacon to JWST even with no stars nearby to light us up. So JWST will be able to find and study human temperature brown dwarfs and compare them with super Jupiters to help settle the brown dwarf debate.